70% of you watching this right now will never get to see the fascinating discovery I've found on this base. And that's simply because, according to my YouTube stats, 70% of people watching my videos don't have the attention span to last through the first 30 seconds. Well, I guess most of you are already gone. So the rest of you will get to see something amazing happening here. And for those who already left, well, what can I tell you? This is going to be a short video because your time is valuable, which is why I only publish quality content. There's an old Chinese proverb that says, it's all in the details, which is why I use microscope and also why it takes more than 30 seconds to explain the details. So those who logged off in the first 30 seconds, well, I guess they'll never get to see the details that we're about to see. So welcome back to Guitar Quackery. Now let's have a look at the details. There is something interesting happening with this bass. It's nothing that I haven't seen before, but it's the first time I'm going to show it. And the only reason why I've seen it before is because I happen to be using a microscope in a guitar repair shop. So that's something for you to see. It's a vintage brand bass, vintage model V4, which means that it's this model, which is obviously a copy of a Fender P bass. This is the headstock. It says vintage, and here it says V4. We are going to be looking at the nut, first at the D string and then at the A string, and then compare the two. Now, this is not it's an inexpensive bass, which means that it's not well made. Obviously, they need to cut corners. And it's because of that that we get to see what we are about to see. So why don't I zoom in on the D string. Here it is. As you can see, the string slot is a little bit wider than it should be. Here, I can even insert this. When we see the situation on a guitar nut or on a bass, we worry about the string wobbling inside of the string slot. Well, in this case, this is really not going to happen because, as you can see, there is no space on this side, and that is because the string tree is pulling the string in this direction a little bit, so it's leaning against this wall. Let's play the string and let's see how it vibrates. You can see that the string is vibrating. And when I initially strike the string, the vibration starts pretty much here at the front of the nut. Watch it. One more time. So this is what I see. It starts to vibrate around here, around this winding. Maybe a little bit of the vibration gets transferred onto this winding, but it doesn't really move inside of the string slot. Now, let's have a look at the A string. Now, this string slot is also a little bit oversized, but you can see space on both sides of the string. And let's just play the string and look at the vibration of the string. Now, I see that this string is actually moving inside of the string slot, somewhere around here. Mm-hmm. you can clearly see that these two windings are moving. Let's look at it again. So there's a little space between this winding and this shaving that we can focus on. And let's look. So you can clearly see that this string is moving inside of the string slot. Now, why is that? Well, first, the string slot is a little bit too wide. And in addition, it's also not properly shaped at the bottom. So this string is actually not really anchored at the bottom of the string slot here. And I believe it's really anchored at the back end of the nut, which is why it moves here. On a guitar, we might worry that the vibrating string inside of the string slot would produce a sitar buzz. Now, we won't really hear that kind of overtone on a bass string, but because the string is moving inside of the string slot, it means that the scale length of that string has been extended in the direction of the headstock, which in turn means that the fretted notes on the first two or three frets will play sharp. So the intonation will be off, and there is really no way to fix it without replacing the nut.
I got more to show you, but before I do, this will be a good time to, you know, click, click, click. And, you know, there's a share link. This way you share the content with the community so everybody can benefit from this. Yeah, and like I said, there's more.
There's an old Chinese proverb that says, when it rains, it pours. So I got another one here. It's also a bass, and it's got the same problem right here. The nut is kind of, well, I've seen better nuts. I'm going to play this string as I focus with the microscope on this string slot over here. So you will be able to see how the string moves inside of the string slot. Let's do it. You can already see when I push the string that the string is in fact moving inside of the string slot. So it's loose at the front and it's anchored at the back end. In fact, you can see some metal deposits through this crack at the back end of the nut. So when I play the string, I think you can clearly see motion inside of the nut. So I think the string vibrates from about here, I think. And remember, every string is actually a little bit stiff between the point where it's anchored and the point where it can freely start to vibrate. But we have all this slack at the front of the nut. I'll be replacing this nut. I believe I'll put a bone nut in place. And that's going to be a separate video. In fact, it will be a live stream, which is going to be streamed live. That's why we call it a live stream on the other channel, Guitar Quackery Live.
That was a Sterling Stingray bass. I ended up making a new nut for it. And I was also live streaming all the work that I did. I did a whole bunch of work on that bass. So check out the other channel, Guitar Quackery Live. I don't know if you know about the channel, but it's another channel. There's a link below. I'll also throw a link for the whole 9-part series of all the work that I did on this base. That's it. Yeah, so if you want to buy me a coffee, you can click the link downstairs that says buy me a coffee. Thank you. And that's about it. So thank you for watching, and let's talk soon.